This week on ANN, Seventh-day Adventist Church leaders elect a new president for the territory in South America.
The Adventist Church in the South Philippines votes to split their territory in two.
And Adventists in St. Vincent feed hundreds of displaced people as volcano continues to erupt.
These stories and more coming up.
Thank you so much for joining us this week.
First in the news, the Seventh-day Adventist Church in South America has elected Stanley Arco, an experienced leader in both Spanish and Portuguese-speaking regions of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, as the president of the division. The South American division is made of 2.8 million members and is divided between eight nations.
The Executive Committee of the General Conference, or GCXCOM, voted to accept the South American Division's Executive Committee recommendation of ARCO for the top leadership position during a special virtual session.
He will replace Erin Kohler, who was recently elected Secretary of the Adventist Church after 14 years as President of the Territory.
During the April 16 session, the South American Division XCOM members also thanked Kohler for his years serving the Adventist Church in the region.
Arco said of his election, "This assignment is a joy, a privilege, and a huge responsibility. I ask for the prayers of every member, of every person wishing for Jesus to come soon. Please pray for me, for all leaders, and for the mission of the Adventist Church in South America and around the world."
Arco was born in southern Brazil and completed a degree in theology at the Adventist Institute of Teaching, now Brazilian Adventist University in Sao Paulo in 1987.
In addition to being a church pastor in Brazil, Arco served as a youth ministries leader across several church regions for 17 years. He also worked as a secretary of the South Paraná Conference in southern Brazil and later as assistant to the SAD president.
A recently concluded special constituency meeting of the South Philippine Union Conference, or SPUC, voted to split the territory into two distinct union organizations. The church work in the SPUC territory is growing rapidly, and it demands more close supervision, monitoring, quick assessment, and evaluation. The region's leaders reported that as the second largest island of the Philippines, Mindanao has more than 37,000 square miles of land area. Church leaders say since its organization in 1964, the area has remained a chance for travel. Splitting the territory into two organizations is the best way to fulfill the mission of the church. While a few delegates push for the addition of more field workers and to suspend the plan for a more favorable time in the future, others saw the potential for further growth when the territory is divided. It has been observed from the divided regional territories of Northern Mindanao and Davao that the work has progressed remarkably in those regions in terms of stewardship, evangelism, and member involvement. As the meeting concluded, delegates voted 229-41 to divide the territory into two unions. After this approval, the action will be sent to Southern Asia Pacific Division, which will advise the union on how to complete all the necessary paperwork in preparation for a final vote by the General Conference. As for the territorial distribution and the boundaries of the two fields, leaders believe the whole process could take another year or two.
For the first time since COVID-19 restricted travel, an Adventist Development and Relief Agency Connections Go Local trip took place from April 12 to 20. The Go Local trip saw seven year 12 and recently graduated students and four staff from Prescott College Southern in South Australia visit Kangaroo Island to help with bushfire recovery efforts. In December 2019, bushfires ripped through the island, burning nearly 50% of the land. Though the fire was declared contained on February 6, 2020, recovery efforts are still taking place across the island, and the community will continue to heal for years to come. The students spent their time on Kangaroo Island helping local farmers and residents with tasks like replacing burned fencing, weeding, and general garden maintenance. Altogether, the students removed 32,000 blue gum seedlings. Over a year has passed since the bushfires ravaged the island, but the impact on the people and the island is still tangible. The resilience of the locals was a key takeaway from the students. The Go Local Connections trip left an impact on both residents and students.
As the La Soufriere volcano continues to spew ash, hot gas, and lava across St. Vincent, The Seventh-day Adventist Church, along with the Adventist Development and Relief Agency, or ADRA, and church member volunteers, has begun providing food and clothing to hundreds who are staying in shelters across the island. More than 20,000 people have been displaced from their homes since the eruption began on April 9.
President of the Seventh-day Adventist Church in St. Vincent and the Grenadines, Dermoth Baptiste, said, "No one has escaped the assault of the volcano, for the entire country has been blanketed with dust, ash, and rubble. Scientists have reported that some areas have up to 2 feet high of ash."
Ash has traveled as far as the neighboring islands of St. Lucia, Grenada, and Barbados. So far, Baptiste reported that 10 Adventist churches were directly affected, and hundreds of members and entire communities had to quickly evacuate the danger zones, many escaping with only the clothes on their backs.
ADRA will assist in an initial one-month response to assist in preparing and distributing hot meals daily for 600 staying in shelters.
Prime Minister of St. Vincent, Dr. Ralph Gonzalez, thanked the church for their leadership in assisting the community as church leaders and volunteers gathered for a press conference at the church's headquarters in Kingstown.
9 Adventist churches and 1 secondary school are being used to shelter over 300 people. Because of COVID-19 restrictions, only essential personnel are allowed to enter.
Baptiste said the church has been able to provide clothing, especially because so many people ran out of their homes with only what they had on. Since Baptiste is unable to visit shelters, he spends his time helping coordinate efforts and provide spiritual encouragement to pastors who are keeping in communication with their members.
In addition to COVID-19 restrictions, more challenges continue to face relief efforts. Many of the roads continue to be impassable. The water system was shut down in the initial days of the eruption because of air contaminants. Government agencies are doing the necessary cleanings to ensure the water is potable.
A shipment of more than 400 cases of water and a large container with bales of rice were just received by church leaders in St. Vincent, thanks to the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Grenada. The donated water and rice will be delivered to the shelters this week. Other supplies are being sent from local fields in neighboring islands.
Church leaders are also planning to provide trauma counseling to those in the shelters as soon as possible.
Coming up, Adventist leaders in Brazil pass out food to those in need due to the COVID-19 pandemic.
And the Adventist Development and Relief Agency's annual disaster relief offering is just around the corner. Find out more up next.
Hi, Theo. How are you? Are you okay?
Dear Theo, I can't even remember how long we've been staying at home now because of this virus. For now, it's just nice to hear your voice and see your face. Nothing beats playing outside in the dirt, though.
Which reminds me, are your hands clean?
Yeah!
Mommy and Daddy says not a lot of kids get COVID-19, but it's always nice to be extra safe.
We should wash our hands before picking our nose.
Washing our hands protects us, but it also keeps us from spreading the virus in case we touch something dirty.
Let's always be clean and safe, okay?
Love, Joey.
We may look, pray, read, think, worship, sing, and share differently, but we all look forward to the Sabbath. And we all look forward to the future when Jesus will come again. With this message in mind, we arrived at a core component for a new identity system, the creation grid, a simple 7-column structure for layout. The grid is a reference both to the prophetic timeline as well as to the creation week that culminated in the seventh-day Sabbath. Regardless of what or where you are designing, you can always find information to help you communicate that we are all Seventh-day Adventists.
Welcome back.
On May 8, the Adventist Development and Relief Agency, or ADRA, will collect a disaster and famine relief offering to benefit their emergency work.
During COVID-19, ADRA has launched more than 400 projects that have reached 20 million people in 96 countries.
Even now, ADRA is launching new projects that will help communities overcome the obstacles that stand between them and the vaccine, as well as provide support to families who are going hungry, children who are out of school, and communities that have been disrupted.
If you would like more information about what ADRA is doing and how you can contribute to their disaster and famine relief offering, visit ADRA.org.
The COVID-19 crisis changed the world. Over the past year, you've helped ADRA meet overwhelming needs in response. With 422 projects that reached 20 million people in 96 countries. But for millions more, this crisis is far from over. Our response is expanding to meet the ongoing and urgent needs. We're helping communities overcome the obstacles to vaccine access, supporting children so they can get back to their education, providing emergency resources to families who are going hungry, and more. We're stronger together, and we need you now.
Recently, the helper class of the Zayoksky Adventure Club in Zayoksky, Russia, visited the Ellen White Research Center, where the children heard inspiring stories from the lives of early church pioneers. Larissa Aksentevna Androsiak told of missionaries from Ellen White's time, as well as modern evangelists. She showed the children photographs and answered their questions. Then they watched a video about the missionary journey of the Apostle Paul. After the presentation, the adventurer leaders asked the children, "Do you want to live an interesting life and never get bored? Then we have a task for you." The leaders gave each child two books, The Great Controversy and Secrets of the Ship. Together with their parents, the children were to think of friends and acquaintances to whom they could donate the books. They had 3 weeks to finish the project. Whoever finished would receive a young evangelist patch and go on a real missionary campaign, visiting poor families and taking them food and toys. Most of the children finished the task and are now looking forward to receiving their evangelist patch.
According to Empower Animal, an association of women that helps animal shelters and independent animal rescues in Brazil, the number of dogs, cats, and other animals rescued in the country last year increased by 70% compared to previous years. The survey included 530 shelters. The organization says that this neglect was accentuated by the worsening humanitarian crisis of COVID-19. In order to assist in alleviating this food shortage, students from the Colegio Adventista de Joinville coordinated a campaign to raise food donations for the animal shelter of Joinville. This initiative started from reading the book The Boy and the Yellow Dog, written by Walda Rosa Abreu, which tells the story of a little dog who spent all day alone, ran away, got lost, and was later adopted by a family who loved animals. Juliana Wuthstrack, a teacher at the academy, says the children are very involved in the collection. She says, "Students understand that they can make a difference in the world. In a campaign like this, everyone gets involved and end up infecting other people with solidarity. They are very fond of animals, and through the book, they understand the importance of loving and caring for pets. The animals in the shelter also deserve our full attention, so we found a way to help during this time of many restrictions."
With the help of pastors and collaborators during the Easter Mutirao in Brazil, the Adventist Church's administrative staff for Rio de Janeiro, Espírito Santo, and Minas Gerais, União Sudeste Brasília, collected and donated 400 basic food baskets.
More than 5 tons of food were distributed on April 18 and 19 to projects in the city of Petropolis, where the church's office is located.
One of the institutions helped was the NGO Sal para a Terra, or Salt of the Earth, which has provided about 100 children with extracurricular activities, tutoring, donations of food baskets, beauty, and health services.
Due to the coronavirus pandemic, the project is only working to distribute food to families in need, including 100 lunches and 150 snacks each afternoon.
The Adventist Church in South America sent this report.
Aqui uma pequena doação dos 102 lá do União Sudeste Brasileira. Muito obrigado e leve a família da União Sudeste Brasileira os nossos agradecimentos em nome do Casa Esperança.
Nós estamos aqui no projeto Vencedor a Cada Dia, é um projeto terapêutico para dependentes químicos e nós temos tido lindas vitórias, onde muitos têm não só se libertado da realidade dos vícios, mas têm conhecido o Senhor Jesus também. E eu tenho muita alegria de representar, junto com o Heber, junto com o Giva e o pastor Leônidas está filmando aqui, os servidores da União Sudeste Brasileira, onde parte daquilo que vocês doaram está vindo para aqui.
Nosso muito obrigado. Muito obrigado mesmo.
Coming up, David Trim is here with This Week in Adventist History.
But up next, we hear from Global Mission Director Gary Krause about what the department and initiatives mean to him.
Why is there evil in the world? Are Christians hypocrites? Is the Bible a fairy tale? Does Jesus love everyone? Church doesn't feel relevant to my life. Is God even real? You have questions? Let's talk about it. I Believe Bible.
Any idea what time it is?
We really, really need our sleep.
Are you from?
No, we're not from the future, but we know you only pay attention to yourselves, so here we are.
But how? We have no time for that. We have less than 30 seconds.
Fact number one, adults need 7 hours of sound, restful sleep to keep their immune systems healthy and to fight viruses. And today, right now, is the single most important thing you can do to keep yourself healthy. What are you doing?
We're just Googling if spicy foods cause hallucinations.
Fact two, staring at your phone or your computer right before bed prevents sound sleep. And you'll be tired the next day. Ain't nobody got time for that.
Can we just go to bed, please?
Welcome back.
Have you ever wanted to know what the Department of Global Mission is? What do they do and how can you be involved?
This week, Tiffany, a church planter, sits down with Gary Cross, Director of Global Mission for the Seventh-day Adventist World Church, to talk about global mission and how it replicates Christ's method.
Adventist Mission has more.
Today I'm excited to be talking with Gary Cross. He is the Director of Global Mission, and he's going to be sharing with us a little bit about how we can be involved in global mission. There's so much happening around the world, and you might be wondering, how can I get involved? How can I be a part of what God is doing around the world? So today we're going to get a chance to hear from him.
Hi, yeah. How are you doing?
Doing great. Even in conversations that I've had with other pastors, there's been this question of what does that mean, holistic mission? Sometimes there needs to be a little bit of clarity of what that looks like.
Okay, well, I can only say what it means to me. And to me, it's the way Jesus modeled his mission.
Yes.
That on the one hand, he preached and he taught. And we can go through the Gospels and we can see that. And if you get a red letter Bible, you can actually see the words that Jesus spoke. But if you look at it, he actually spent more of his time healing the sick, ministering to people's emotional and physical needs. And so on the one hand, he's sharing the good news of the kingdom verbally, but he's also demonstrating it through his actions. And so, you know, the best summary that I have seen of Christ's method is what Ellen White talks about in Ministry of Healing, page 143, that I just mentioned before. You have those components of mingling, showing sympathy, ministering to needs, winning confidence, and bidding people to follow Jesus. Now, life is messy, and you can't just say, okay, I'm on stage one, now I'm moving to stage two, stage. But it's a whole picture, and if we neglect any of those elements, then we sabotage mission. So if we are only interested in preaching, teaching, giving people seminars, giving people Bible studies, but we have not invested in their lives, if we haven't listened to them, if we haven't wept tears with them, if we haven't laughed with them, they're going to have an intellectual knowledge of these certain beliefs that we've given them, but are they going to be grounded as disciples in Jesus? Have they got that network that, you know, I use the example of Velcro that sticks things together. And if you look under the microscope, it's a combination of hooks and loops that come together, and you push them together, then you can pull them apart. And if you only have one hook and loop, maybe intellectual knowledge about Jesus, that's very easy to pull apart. But if you've had a holistic mission where you've actually, Jesus has touched your heart, not just a head, and where you've actually experienced a fellow Christian caring for your physical needs, you feel you've got a tighter bond, and discipleship is going to be that much stronger. So that's what I'm talking about, holistic mission. Not just, I mean, I believe in the literature ministry. I think media is wonderful. And we need all those things, but they can only support, they cannot replace one-on-one contact. I mean, Jesus was not content to stay in heaven and send us a leaflet. He wasn't content to send us, you know, 28 fundamental beliefs on a piece of paper. He actually came down here, he got his hands dirty, he put on human skin, he became one with us, because that's how you do mission. Sorry, I'm preaching too much.
Yeah, no, I love that. That's huge. It's incarnational. I am with you. It's not an us or them where it's like, okay, I'm over here. What can we go over there to reach them? But I'm actually here in this. This is a we. This is our. We are in this together, and I'm here to do life with you. Exactly. Such a different approach. It's instead of like, how can we change them? It's like, wow, this is changing me. And we're changing together, and let's see where God is taking us together. So I love that.
Watch this and other mission stories online by visiting AdventistMission.org, then clicking on videos at the top.
And finally, for today's episode, let's turn to David Trim for a look at Adventist history.
Welcome to This Week in Seventh-day Adventist History. On April 26 in 1898, the first baptism in Bulgaria took place in the city of Rusa. Lying near the border with Romania, Rusa is Bulgaria's fifth largest city, and at the time there were already a number of Seventh-day Adventists in the city. They were ethnically Armenian women who had fled the persecution of Christians in the Ottoman Empire. They witnessed to their neighbors, and Ludwig R. Conradi, president of the European Union Conference, who was traveling through Russia and Romania, took time to visit Rusa, where he baptized two local people. Today, the Bulgarian Union of Churches has 7,000 members worshiping in 225 congregations. That means there's one church member for every 995 people in Bulgaria. So, 123 years after those first baptisms in Bulgaria, the church there is still very small and greatly needs your prayers. On April 28, 1960, Frithjof Mudesbach, Danish missionary, died near Utumbaru in what was then called Tanganyika, today's Tanzania. Mudesbach and an African colleague, Pastor Manjali, were driving back to Utumbaru mission station after a workers' meeting when they were caught in a flood and both drowned. Frithjof Mudesbach had been born in Denmark in 1900 into an Adventist family, many of whose members served as missionaries in Africa. As a young man, Frithjof worked as a literature evangelist in Sweden and then as a nurse. His wife, Borghilda, was also a nurse, and they married in December 1924. The next year, they were called to missionary service in Tanganyika, where Frithjof was ordained. The Mudesbachs later worked in Uganda, where Frithjof was mission president. For 3 years in the late 1940s, Borghild and Frithjof were back in Denmark, where he served as a conference president. But in 1950, the Mudesbachs returned to Africa, working in Uganda, Kenya, and finally Tanganyika. They spent 32 of the 35 years from 1925 to 1960 as missionaries in Africa. That was This Week in Adventist History.
Thanks for watching ANN. Join us next week for more news from the headquarters of the Seventh-day Adventist Church.
Did you know the Adventist Church has a YouTube channel where you can watch ANN video, ANN in-depth, and plenty of other amazing videos on prophecy, health, and Bible study?
Just go to YouTube and search for the Adventist Church. Click the subscribe button to make sure you're caught up each week.
And remember, leave a comment or prayer request. We have people who are praying for you 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
Before we say goodbye, here's some good news from the book of Lamentations, chapter 3, verses 25 and 26.
The passage says, "The Lord is good to those whose hope is in him, to the one who seeks him. It is good to wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord."
That's our program for this week. And remember, you can always visit Adventist.news for daily news and videos. Until next time, God bless.
Take care.